Assalaamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to part 2 of the Ayah 56 from Surat Al Ahzab. My dear sisters and my brothers, there is a golden rule that must be followed every time we want to study an ayah or more from the Quran, or we look into anything that happens around us as we get to live our life. The rule is this: anything that can happen on earth must happen within a place and a time. The same thing for the Quran. Each ayah must have a place where it was revealed and a time where it was revealed. So for any ayah to be effective, there has to be a place where it was revealed and also a time when it was revealed. There is not one single ayah in the entire Quran that does not fulfill this golden rule. Therefore, we can assume with certainty that the entire Quran was revealed in the Arabian Peninsula. As for the time, it was revealed when the messenger was alive. As soon as he was dead, the Quran stopped being revealed. And this is extremely important, and you will see why. Because Muhammad the human was used by Allah to channel to humanity the content of the Quran, so that other humans who lived, and as I said in one of my talks, it was destined for the Arabs, but they did what they did. But anyhow, so the Quran was to be taken to the humans for them to study and lead a better life. So this is the whole purpose of this messengership. Some of the Quran is timeless and can be applied anytime until the end of the world, while other parts of the Quran had their time where they were only valid for that place where it happened and also the time when it was descended. I'm going to give here two examples, one of timeless Quran and one of the timed Quran. For example, when Allah says in the Quran, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ وَبَنَاتُكُمْ وَأَخَوَاتُكُمْ till the end, it was made haram on you to marry your mothers, your daughters, your sisters, etc. And this is in Surah number 4 and Nisa, Ayah 23. This is timeless. From the time the Quran was revealed until the end of time, marrying one's mother, daughter, sister, all that kind of stuff is haram and not accepted. Guess what? In the entire earth, this rule applies. There is no country that allows marriage from a mother or a daughter or a sister or things like that, or a brother or things like that. Incest, what they call incest. So this timeless ayah makes incest haram until the end of time. Good for that. But now I'll give you an example of a timed Quran, i.e. the ayah that was for a specific time, for a specific place, for a specific people. And it is the ayah we are talking about, that Allah and His angels do their salat on the Prophet. You who believe, you do the same thing, and we'll explain later on. That is the ayah 56 from Surah 33. This ayah and this story are timed. They are no longer relevant for us. Allah told us about what had happened, but there is nothing for us to apply from this ayah. I put the English translations here so that you know what I am referring to. And this doesn't mean I agree with what they say. So when I say Allah and His angels give blessings to the Prophet, it's just something to refer to, because later on when I explain the meaning, you will see why I am saying what I am saying now. I disagree with that translation, but I just to give you an idea of what I am talking about. Because Ayah 56 from Surat Al-Ahzab, that is 33, has and still is greatly misused. Let us take a look at it, because the meaning of this ayah is very, very different than what has been deceptively presented to Muslims through the last 15 centuries. The deception has been going on for centuries. I'm not talking one century, two, three. We're talking 14 and almost 60 years. We're coming up to the 15 centuries. Even though the Quran has always been clear about it, but as usual, the men of religion, and what I mean by that is the Sheikhs, school of thoughts, the Hadith narratives, opinions, etc. I call them men of religion, or sometimes I call them men of cloth, chose to pick what they wanted. and what they liked or what their school of thought liked, and they hid the rest until falsehood became truth and truth itself became alienated. Our men of religion, exactly as the Jewish rabbis and Christian priests, chose and picked what served them and their agendas and hid the rest. Our men of religion did and still are doing the very same thing, cheating us of the truth unashamedly. Just like that, they hid from us. That's why we are in the state we are in. I'm going to start here by setting up the scene in which this ayah was revealed to have a better understanding of it. You see, when this ayah was cut off from the body in which it was revealed, it became a source of dispute and confusion. The disorientation is very serious, really. See, the men of religions can't seem to agree on one meaning. So what did Allah really mean when he said him and his angels do salat on the messenger, then he ordered the believers to copy him and his angels, then the scholars deferred on an endless numbers of possibilities. You see, at this moment, it is extremely important to understand that Ayah 56 of Allah and his angels do the salat wasn't revealed by itself. It was not an orphan ayah. It was not just like an ayah like that. No. It was part of a whole package, part of a whole family of other ayat. It was part of a whole story. It was part of a whole event that took place. The fact that it is mentioned by itself, unaccompanied by the rest, completely detached from its context and isolated, means that it can and was easily distorted and manipulated to mean what it originally didn't mean at all. The context of Ayah 56 was not revealed singularly by itself. And what I mean by this, my dear sisters and my brothers, is this. Ayah 56, in which Allah states that him and the angels do the salat on the Prophet, etc., was not descended by itself for its own sake. See, deep, like that. Just Allah descended like that. He felt like, okay, let's do it and let's raise the status of Muhammad more. No, it did not. In fact, it was revealed as part of a whole well-known event. And once you understand this event and the context in which it was revealed, the meaning of this ayah will charge at you. It will change. It will come, and suddenly the ayah will jump out at you, looking you upright inside the depth of your soul. And suddenly, it shines a light in the darkness of ignorance, what you have been told. And suddenly, everything makes sense. My golden advice to you, my dear sisters and my dear brothers, and if I have to give you one piece of advice, it will be this. Always, always, always do understand any ayah in the context, in the story, in the topic, in the event it was, is revealed in. Never ever isolate an ayah from its context. Because if you happen to do that, or if someone does that, they can play. That's why the Quran is one book. Allah says there is no difference in the Quran, yet you find one sheikh using one ayah to say something is halal, another sheikh using the same ayah to say something is haram. And we have two contradicting, really head-on contradicting arguments. And then we tell the world, oh, the Bible and the Torah are forced. There are forgeries in there, there are manipulations, and the Quran is 100% clean, clear, everything. Yet, when we go to our books, we found calamities. So, to get out of that, always, always, always read the ayah in the context it was revealed. And number two, imagine yourself as the messenger of Allah who received the ayah. No school of thoughts, no arguments, no sheikhs, no agendas. You are an employee of Allah, and Allah has descended this ayah on you. How do you deal with it? This is how I deal with the entire Quran. I never put something that I like. I always act as if I am a messenger of Allah. I am not, of course, but as you get the idea. And I take the Quran as it has been revealed unto me. As the truth of the fact is, we should all do that. because the Quran is an SMS, a message, WhatsApp message from Allah to you. Except on the phone we use WhatsApp, and Allah used Muhammad. Because if you isolate one ayah from the context, manipulations and the forgeries, like we have seen for centuries, will keep existing. But because of political gains in the past, when Muslims were a strong empire and everything, the man of religion distorted so many things. All this to help the agendas of the rulers, kings and everything. And the problems we are paying for them until now. I will jump at an extremely important point here, which will serve us later on, and that is to speak about a kafir. Who is a kafir? Why Muslims today in England or wherever they are in the world, why do they consider the Europeans, for example, as kafir? One day someone said to me, Alhamdulillah, I am not one like this kuffar. And I told him, who are you talking about? And then he pointed with his hand to all the English people, we're in England. I told him, who gives you that authority to say these people are kafir? He said to me, and this is where the danger is, because these people are not Muslim. I said to him, so to you, someone who is not Muslim is kafir? He goes, of course. I said, but that is not what Allah says in the Quran. And you know what? He looked at me as if I told him that Muhammad is there. Look at him. It's completely taken aback. What do you mean? Because calling people kafir or kuffar just because they don't believe in what we believe in is a very, very wrong and strong accusation we cannot prove on Judgment Day. On Judgment Day, when Allah holds somebody and he says, why did you say these people are kafir? And if someone is going to say, oh, because they were not Muslims, Allah is going to tell him, where did you get that understanding from? Oh, you cannot tell him, oh, the Sheikh said, because on Judgment Day is you and Allah, the Sheikh will run away from you. This is why, my dear sisters and my brothers, Allah didn't give any human any right to issue the kufr statement on anyone. The only one who can issue this kufr statement is Allah. That is because He knows what we cannot possibly know. You see, what the other people think or believe in the depth of their hearts and souls, and the reason why they believe is that we cannot reach it. We are not faith investigators or classifiers. We're not faith police. Allah is, and He deserves this right only to Him, because He is the only one who can know what is in the depth of somebody and why they're doing what they are doing. You see, you, me, anyone else on earth cannot really tell who the kafir is and who the kafir is not. How can you tell someone is hiding a belief when you have no access to their inner thoughts? Maybe someone is just angry and anger is blinding them. You see, this is why Allah has clearly mentioned in the Quran that only Him, not the angels, not Jibreel, not Muhammad, nothing, only Him and Him all alone knows who the disbeliever is and who the kafir or who the believers are. Our job is not to categorize people, but rather to get to know humanity. You see, it was politics and the desires to invade countries that influenced this takfir disease, which has plagued us for centuries, until Muslims are killing each other in Muslim countries just because a group sees other people who don't subscribe to their thoughts or beliefs are kafirs. So where did this disease of takfir come from? Well, it came from a time when the Muslims didn't have an organized army. They didn't have armies, soldiers who they trained, just like the Romans, Persians, and the superpower of the old times. In the Arab Muslim world back then, from the in the life of the messenger, about 40 years after his life, Arabs or Muslims hadn't had any armies. They didn't have armies. In the past, going to war was absolutely voluntarily act. You volunteer as a soldier. You were not a trained soldier. There were no armies, as I said, per se. So when a battle was going to be fought, the leader or the Khalifa, whatever it is, would call on the people and tribes and cities to go with him to war, to amass and gather the biggest number of warriors the leader and his propaganda machine, which at that time were the men of religion. You see, in the old days, the machine, the media machines, the newspaper, the television, the websites, everything were run by men of religion. The men, why? Because people trusted them. So the governors and kings and khalifa, everybody used the men of religion to relay their messages to the people. So back in time, they would use rhetorics, they would do all kinds of motivational persuasions to push people to go to war, to join the army. The biggest expression that they found that delivered the biggest impact on people was for the sheikhs, the scholars, for all, to call the enemies kuffar. It was enough for Muslims of the old days to understand that those who are going to be fought or they are going to fight are kuffar. That was enough for them. That term had its weight in gold. And guess what? The sheikhs did just that. They used to push the agenda of these people are kuffar, and who wants to die for the sake of Allah? This is why today the highest wish for any Muslim out there is that they die for the sake of Allah. And why do they want to do that? Well, it's simple. Because the moment you die for the sake of Allah, you are considered a martyr, a shaheed, as the Arabs like to call it. And the moment you die for the sake of Allah, guess what? You will have some extremely high rewards. Well, they tell you, from the moment the first drop of blood comes out of you, you will have all your sins forgiven. You will get to see your place in paradise. You will be interned in paradise and have over 70 beautiful virgin women. You sleep with them as much as you want. You finish with one, she becomes virgin. The perversion at its highest, but hey, guess what? That's the world. That's what the Sheikh promised. That's what we say. And then also you can intercede for over 70 members of your family. And on top of all this, you will be with the messenger of Allah, and your body will not decompose. And as I said, you will have 70 mind-blowing sexy women in paradise. Why wouldn't I want to die for all this? I can spend a life of sins, and guess what? All I have to do, take a wash one day and say La ilaha illallah, get a gun, go die, and that's it. I get all this. All these lies have been sold to people in the past. Of course, as I said, none of the above is true. If someone dies, the war is a war, and Allah knows why the people are dying. But most of our wars that have happened before, the Muslims were the oppressors, were the transgressors. They are, oh God, I don't want to speak about that. I've spoken about a talk of the most insane thing that you will ever hear in your life. And please go on YouTube and listen to it. I explain more about these things. They told the stories of nonsense, like the martyrs, the body of a martyr won't be eaten by earth. And people, Muslims are really, they have this, I don't know what's wrong with their mind. I swear to Allah, what's wrong with that? I don't know. Because if a hadith says that the body of a martyr doesn't get eaten by earth, guess what? There are countries, and recently I think in Algeria, they found out that in France they have a skeleton of martyrs in a museum. And they dug some graves and they found bones there. But that means one of the two. It's either these people are the martyrs, as you call them, or they are imposters because they have skeleton. Yet they call them martyrs and they have skeleton. And this lie goes against any logic. Allah didn't say that. All bodies that are buried in earth shall be eaten by the bacteria inside us, even prophets and messengers. If we dug the prophet's Muhammad grave, we will find him skeleton, and I am willing to bet my life for that. We won't find him as he was, as he died, Chris. And if we go, they tell you, if you go to Medina and you dig out the graves of the companions there, you will find them as they were. One day somebody told you a lie that some flood came in and they dug there and they found the blood, and they brought some scholars from Saudi Arabia, and these scholars dug out the graves of people and they found that the blood is still running from them. I don't really believe it. Why haven't they showed any videos? Oh, because it's gruesome. I said, no, it's because it's a lie. That's what it is. Let me give you an example of kufr that you, my sisters, or my brothers, might experience on a daily basis. And say you are driving on a motorway and the speed limit is 70 miles per hour or 100 kilometers per hour. But you know the speed limit is 70 miles or 100 kilometers. But you decide to ignore the speed limit and drive at 80 or 130 kilometers per hour. So what you have done here is you have gone way above the speed limit while knowing that what you are doing is illegal. Miles or kilometers later, you get caught and the policeman tells you, you have been speeding, which is a fact. But you decide you don't want a ticket and you don't want points on your driver's license. And for that, you start finding ways to get out of this problem. So you start denying the facts. While you know they are true, you were speeding and you saw your speedometer, so you know what you are doing. But you deny because you don't want the points, you don't want the fine. As you deny these things, you become a deliberate coverer. The deliberate coverer is what the Quran refers to as kafir. This is why when Allah ended an ayah, He ends it by, and these are the kuffar. What Allah means by the kuffar is people who knew exactly what they rejected, and they know it's the truth, and they deliberately rejected. These are the deliberate coverers. Cover, kafir, it's the same root word. A kafir is not someone who doesn't know what you believe in. A kafir is someone who knows exactly what you believe in and denies it. I'll give an example for myself, yeah? I know, for example, as a fact, that some people out there believe deep inside their heart that Allah is the creator, the Quran is true. But because they have some issues with somebody, they keep denying, oh, I don't believe in God. While deep inside them, they believe in God, but they say they believe in God. These people are the kafir. Why? Because he knows what he is denying. Allah has explained this concept clearly in the Quran. Look at what he says. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ. Yet when there came to them, to the Jews at the time of the messenger, where they came to them that which they knew very well, they denied it. Then Allah says, فَلَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. So let the curse of Allah be upon the kafirin, which should be translated as the deliberate coverers. You can find this ayah in Surat Al-Baqarah, the surah number 2, ayah 89. In the books of translations, they used for kafirin the word disbelievers. And they are extremely wrong. They're very wrong. A disbeliever is someone who doesn't believe in what you believe in. Let me give you an analogy to help you understand this concept. And after this concept, you will understand why so many things are so very wrong and why our men of religion were so wrong in so many things. I'm going to give you the cow analogy. If you met someone who worships a cow and you don't believe in that, as far as the other person is concerned, you are a disbeliever. You don't believe in the worship of cows. That's end of it. Okay, so for you to qualify as a kafir, you must believe that worshipping a cow is the true religion, and then you go deliberately deny and hide that fact. You are a kafir now. You see the huge difference between disbeliever and kafir? They are not the same thing. Someone is not and cannot be considered a kafir until and unless they fully understand and accept as truth whatever it is they deliberately reject and cover. So if I go to an English person and I ask them about Islam, they have no idea about it. I can't call them a kafir. I can't even call them a disbeliever. It's just someone following another religion. End of it. So for someone, one more time, for someone to be a kafir, they must and they need to understand well what they are rejecting. As a golden rule, my sisters and my brothers, avoid calling any human out there as kafir. Don't call English, Hindu, Sikhs, don't call them kafir. Leave that to Allah to decide on judgment day who the kafir, deliberate cover or deliberate denier is and is not. It is not my job to categorize people. This is why there is judgment day. Judgment day is for all this purpose. It is Allah's job to decide who and who is not a deliberate cover, a kafir. This understanding is crucial to understanding what Allah wants from us in the Quran. Reason: the misrepresentations of this concept have driven Muslims against wars of oppression and bloodshed in killing different races on Allah's earth without any right. So how important was the ayah about the status of the Prophet in our lives? So to truly understand the Quran as a whole, and the Ayah 56 in particular, we must first know about the place and time and the conditions of the revelation. So let's ask few questions to help us nail down this issue about Allah and the angels doing their Salat and us copying Allah and the angels. Why wasn't this Ayah revealed in Mecca? Why didn't Allah alleviate the status of His Messenger in Mecca? It would have served better there. Why did Allah wait until towards the end of His life's Messenger to reveal it? And we are talking about the last 4 years or so of His life. Was this ayah revealed by itself as a general rule, or was it revealed as part of an ensemble which dealt with some particular situation or event? Was it just a piece of information of what Allah and His angels were doing, or was it something else? There are many other questions that can be asked here about this ayah. And this research paper, this talk, if you will, seeks to answer them all, because by knowing the answer, you will gain some knowledge which will protect you from the misdoings, future misdoings, and past doings of the man of religion or anyone out there that tries to sell you what the people of old have invented. You will immune and be immune against all lies and misinformations that are spread out there, and believe me, they have been spread there for many centuries. Let's get into the 56, the Ayah 56, Allah and His angels doing the Salat, and the context. You see, the story behind the revelation of Ayah 56 actually starts from Ayah 53 all the way to 62 from Surah 33. Meaning, the context of this Ayah starts from the Ayah 53 and goes all the way until 62. That's 10 Ayat. These 10 Ayat talk about the context of Allah and His angels doing their Salat on the Messenger. Again, 56 is not an isolated, it's part of a package. The package starts from 53 all the way to 62. Now, taking a single ayah from this context family is like taking a child away from his family and then build him a history of nothing from nothing, and then you present it to the world, this child is with that history. Well, in fact, he is not. Yet the man of religion unashamedly just did what I just told you. They isolated this ayah, gave it a different meaning, and sold it to the Muslims, and Muslims idiotically are following something that doesn't exist, and they expect a reward. Until somebody told me one day, if you want Allah to answer your dua, make a lot of Salat on the Messenger and Allah will answer. Guess what? 1400 years and Muslims live in poverty, in oppression. They are stupid idiots. They can't read. Why didn't Allah do anything? Every time they mention Muhammad, they say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Why didn't He do that? So let's start with the place of occurrence. This ayah took place in Al-Madinah. Al-Madinah is the city the Messenger of Allah fled to and died in. The number of inhabitants of Al-Madinah was extremely modest. It's not like millions. Actually, there were in Medina at the time when the Messenger was in Mecca, and before he left to Medina, then at that period of time, there were two big tribe, Arab tribes, and they were rivals, always fighting. One of them is called the Aus, and the other one is called the Khazraj. It's like tribe A, tribe B, tribe the Aus, tribe the Khazraj. These two tribes would get into endless battles for some senseless and banal reasons, for nonsense really. The Aus and the Khazraj lived with them in the outskirts of Al-Madinah three other Jewish tribes. They are the sons of Qurayda. There is a man whose name is Qurayda, and this is his tribe. The sons of Qaynuqa, Banu Qaynuqa, and the sons of An-Nadir. These are three tribes from the children of Israel, from the Jews. These three Jewish tribes spoke Arabic, and they spoke also their own mother tongue, Hebrew. They also, the Jews, they were extremely business people. They used to take advantage of the wars between the two Arabs, and at time they would instigate the wars. But what they did was, a part of the Jewish people would invest in the Aus, and the other people would invest in the Khazraj. Back in time, the Arabs didn't have the art of building weapons. So the Jews would hire, they used to have shops to hire swords, spears, and all this kind of, and then before you start the war, you go and rent it from there, and they used to make a lot of money like that. When the messenger of, and also the Jews used to build on alliances. One day they ally with this one, the other day they are with that one, and all these political turmoils were there. So when the messenger of Allah arrived to Al-Madinah fleeing from Mecca, it was two big tribes, Al-Aus and Al-Khazraj, and the sons of Qurayda, Qaynuqa, and An-Nadir. All these people were there living in their own things. The Jewish had their own religion. The Arabs were influenced with some traditions of the Jews, but they were not Jews. They believed in anything. So the Prophet Muhammad came there, and that's what he found. The population of the city of Medina, when the messenger got to it, was about 10,000 people. That's the number of people in general of Al-Madinah. When the people of from Mecca migrated, and the local resident known as Al-Ansar, which is the supporters of the messenger, after so many years, towards the last 4 years of Islam, that is 13 plus 7, 20 years since Al-Islam came, the number of Muslims got to give and take about 2,000 people. After 20 years, that's what it is. Of these 2,000 people, you take the children, you take things, so the Muslims are always a minority. With time, and after some Muslims returned from Abyssinia, which is Ethiopia today in current times, and some conversions of some Arabs, and some people migrated to Al-Madinah, and some people came, so Al-Madinah became like a hub. Anyone who embraced Islam anywhere in the Arabian Peninsula would go to Al-Madinah. Also, my dear sisters and my brothers, Al-Madinah was a cosmopolitan city. It had, compared to other small tribes, it was the city, the biggest city in the Middle East. So people would go there, and they would all pivot towards there. So add to that, they embrace Islam. They used to think like, oh my God, if I go to Al-Madinah, I have already got a messenger there. I've got Muslims there. They're going to support me. And that's how the number of people started gradually moving towards Al-Madinah. And at one point, Al-Madinah became half believers, half non-believers, and at that time the number of population was about 12,000 people. So there were about 6,000 people, believers from all the different tribes, and the people from Mecca were about 300-400 people that came from Mecca. It's not that much. The rest are made from inhabitants, Al-Ansar, the supporters, and other people from other things. The three Jewish tribes were doing their best at practicing the Torah. And the two Arabs, as I said, had no religion, and they were just following their ancestors' beliefs. Now, you might ask yourself, why did the Jewish tribes end up there? Why did they live in Medina? Why not didn't they go to where the other Jews were, in what's called today Palestine, and live there? Why were they in Al-Madinah? Well, it really is simple. In the Torah, after Jesus came, it said that the next prophet would come from the Arabs. So many groups of the Jewish people went to the biggest agglomeration or city, that is in Al-Madinah, hoping that one of them will be sent as a prophet. Since they are already the chosen people of God and they have the Torah, maybe God will pick up somebody who spoke Arabic from them. They even used to boast themselves over this issue on the Arabs of Al-Madinah. They used to tell them, you know what? The lost prophet will come from us. And this Allah used as an argument against the Jews later on. And he says, وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ كِتَابٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. And when a law came to them from Allah, and Allah is speaking about the Quran, مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ, which corroborates and reinforces what was with them, because the Quran states that the Torah was sent down to the children of Israel. So the Quran is on the side of the Jews. And then Allah adds a small expression which is extremely important. Speaking about the Jews, he says, وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلِ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And they, i.e. the Jews, the three tribes, used to threaten with the coming of the messenger from them against those who disbelieved, i.e. the Arabs of Al-Madinah. So the Jews used to tell the Arabs, as soon as the next Messiah, the next messenger shall come out, and he's going to come out in these parts of the world, we will deal with you. So the Aus and the Khazraj used to be scared of this. But, you know, they used to fight it scared, until the Prophet Muhammad came. And when Muhammad came, the Jews knew very well that he was the messenger that Allah spoke about it. But guess what? They deliberately denied it and covered it, and that's why Allah calls them kafir. Can I call a Jew today kafir? I cannot, because he hasn't seen Muhammad, he sees nothing. Unless that Jewish person believes 100% that the Quran is the truth, that the Quran must be followed, that, and he carries on and denies it. In which case, I cannot know for sure that he's kafir, only Allah knows that. So my dear sisters and my brothers, now we know how Al-Madinah was there. Al-Madinah, a city being what it is very much unlike Mecca. Mecca is a small town, nothing was big about it, nothing was unique about Mecca. But Al-Madinah was a cosmopolitan and worldly city. Back then, over 1450 years ago, when the tribes that used to live there, they used to have big market. So with the standards of the old days, Al-Madinah was like New York City, or was like London or Paris, or one of those big cities. When the Messenger of Allah migrated to Al-Madinah, and here I wanted to open your ears and pay attention, because now we get into the context where these stories started happening. When the Messenger of Allah migrated to Al-Madinah, Al-Madinah had its political system already established. It had its rulers, it had its deputies, it had everything was already set, and people were living fine. Then suddenly somebody comes in, a man runs from elsewhere, from Mecca, Muhammad I'm talking here. And when he gets to Al-Madinah, the people of Al-Madinah knew that with the coming of this man, it would put them into a political conflict with not only Mecca, but with all the Arabs. Because this man is calling to something, i.e. believing in Allah, the Quran, things like that, that the other Arabs don't like. Suddenly Al-Madinah became a center of attention. And a tension started building up. The Prophet Muhammad, in the early days when he migrated to Mecca, he was himself and maybe 5-10 people. It was not a big deal. Remember, the Muslim numbers were a minority. So what happened? With time, the other Muslims around the Arabian Peninsula started migrating to Al-Madinah. The huge majority of those who migrated to Al-Madinah were broke. They were poor people. When they got to Al-Madinah, they didn't have any wealth. They couldn't rent, they couldn't do business, and suddenly they became a problem on the people of Al-Madinah. Al-Madinah was full of junkies, people who cannot find food, people who have not a thing. When they got there, Muslims are really peculiar people. Anyone who disagrees with us is either a kafir or a hypocrite. And that's why they refer to the people who rejected the idea that Muslims should come to Al-Madinah, bring their own political problem, bring in the insecurities to Al-Madinah, and on top of that, bring in all the financial problems with them. Al-Madinah now is overburdened by to feed these people, find them a place where to live, and also if they forsake and all these things. So Al-Madinah, so what they did, they started doing a small strategy to reject, to not encourage people to come to Al-Madinah. We live in England. England has got a very nice system, social system, to help people and things like that. Back in the 80s and 90s, I used to hear it in the masjid myself, where people used to tell people from the family, from different parts of the world, come to England, the British government takes good care of people. And I remember in the 90s, some groups from Africa started coming, and guess what? They were in their country, homeland, there were fights and wars and battles and everything. When they came to London, I remember the very first ones, I saw them coming, and I started, okay. And then they went like crazy, lying to the British government, taking an accommodation, two, sometimes three. They would separate from their wives, and then they don't separate, they're still married. But they go to the council and lie to them, so that the council gives a house to the man and a house to the woman. And guess what? It happened. The council gave, and then with time, the council figured out what was happening and they cracked down. But you know what? Most of the children of these people didn't turn up good people, because they saw their parents lie. The father coming home, hiding from the council and things like that. All these kind of problems were taken to Al-Madinah. So the people of Al-Madinah wanted to devise a strategy not to push, so that to push people away from Al-Madinah. So what does strategy was, لا تنفقوا على من عند رسول الله حتى ينفضوا. Do not spend on those with the messenger of Allah, so that they break away from him. Why? Because the people of Al-Madinah were generous. They were taking care of these people, broke people. But the majority who didn't want them said, hey, why are you spending on them? Don't spend on them. This way, they will find themselves into problems and they will leave. An economical embargo, if you will. Of course, us, our sheikhs, they say, oh, these are the hypocrites. No, it was not the hypocrites. It was the majority of Al-Madinah to say that. To remediate this problem, Allah continuously encouraged the believers to spend, to donate, to support their brothers and sisters in this new faith. Allah wanted so much to help. Allah could have made the sky rain on Muslims. Muslims could have gone to bed the next day, wake up with bags of diamonds by them. But he didn't. Subhanallah, he didn't. Why did he? Because Allah doesn't do this kind of things. He wants us to help each other to work. And then what did he do? When people, the Muslims, were stingy, they didn't do, they were not as supportive as they should have, Allah put his own self, subhanallah, forward. He goes, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا. Who is it that will lend Allah a good loan? This qard hasan, this good loan, people today, they say, oh, it's qard hasan, I want to go get qard hasan. No, you don't do it. Allah won't accept it from you. This happened, this is of the timed Quran. This happened at one point and it ended there. There is no such thing as good loan. You don't do that. But anyhow, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا. Who amongst you believers that will lend Allah a good loan, فَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا, so that when Allah shall pay it back, will multiply it many folds. وَاللَّهُ يَقْبِضُ وَيَبْسُطُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. It is Allah who withholds wealth and extends it, and to him you all are returned. The reason Allah said it is him who extends and withholds wealth, because Allah can do these things. He's telling the believers of that time, it is not because I cannot, but it's because I have set some rules and I don't want to break them. That's all there is to it. So what an offer this is. You support the new immigrants to Medina so that they don't become a burden on the city. And then consider yourself as a direct lender to Allah, the creator of it all. That's it. And when the time to pay you back, Allah will multiply it many folds. Why did Allah do that? Well, it's simple really. When the messenger went to Al-Madinah and he chose to flee there and everything, Allah wanted to push Islam. Allah is so... He wants people to believe, because he doesn't want to punish them on Judgment Day. But now the political issues are causing problems to the promotion of Islam. So Allah wants to take care to resolve this problem, so that the call to Islam becomes non-problematic. So when Allah put his offer on the table, the inhabitants of Medina spread a new lie. They spread a lie in hope to prevent people getting interested in this new faith. And they call it the invading faith. Allah says, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَةٌ. When Allah said to the believers, spend and I will multiply it many further, lend me money and I will return it, what? They said, Allah says, Allah has heard the statement of those who said, Allah is indeed poor, while we are rich. And this is in Surah 3, Ali Imran, Ayah 181. Contrary what it is said, Medina wasn't at all converted to Islam. They tell you in the books of history, Mus'ab ibn Umair went there and he worked in Al-Madina. Al-Madina was happy for the Prophet to go there, and they were singing and dancing. All that is a lie. All that is a lie. People weren't happy at all. When the messenger arrived to Al-Madina, he brought with him a slew of big number of problems. Danger, economics, politics, and everything. Only a very small portion of its inhabitants did believe. The majority didn't believe at all. So what they tell you, Wallahi al-Azim, the number of lies. This is why the Quran cannot come to the forefront of these things. But anyhow, when the messenger was given permission to flee to Mecca, as I said, guess what? He went there seeking security. He was there seeking asylum. He wanted to be safe, as they call it, the asylum seeker. That's it. And when the messenger got there, he understood very well that he didn't choose to go to Al-Madina. He was forced by his own people to flee Mecca. Always we tell the migration of the messenger to Mecca, to Medina, but in fact it is not a migration, it was a fleeing. Allah says, كَمَا أَخْرَجَكَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَيْتِكَ بِالْحَقِّ. It is like when your Lord made you flee your home with the truth, with the Quran. And Allah says, وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكَرِيهُونَ. While a group from the believers who migrated with you, who flee with you, were totally against it. Yes, a lot of believers in Mecca, they went to Al-Madina, but they didn't want to go there. Allah says this in Surah Al-Anfal, Surah 8, the ayah number 4. So, in Medina, as I have said, a lot of problems started occurring financial. The new, and I want you to pay attention here, because now, they hid this from you all the way, okay? But I'll say it, alhamdulillah, and I don't care what they say. So many Muslims, when they got to Al-Madina, it was financial problems. Some people in Al-Madina who were already struggling before saw in the newcomers a new opportunity to make wealth. The Muslims who came to Al-Madina found themselves in a new city, but they don't have a job, they don't have a house, there is no way for them to generate any income, and they took another way to making money. Guess what is this way? Prostitution of women. So many women who embraced Islam and migrated from Mecca, from other places, started prostituting their bodies to make a living. The prostitutes in Al-Madina saw in the newcomers a good opportunity for business. Guess what? And they did business. I know they hid this because they made you believe that the companions were like this angelic group of people. Once they believed in the messenger and the messenger was with them, they grew up wings and they flew. That's it. They became like, no. Women in Al-Madina, the Medinians, so to speak, they started pushing their business. The prostitutes from Mecca and the people, they started selling them. And that's why Allah Ta'ala revealed in Al-Quran, الزَّانِيَةُ وَالزَّانِي, the female and the male fornicators, what should we do with them? Give each of them 100 lashes. And then he states that these 100 lashes must be done in public and you must not have any mercy on them. Guess what? When the ayah was revealed, any believer that committed fornication, either a woman prostitute or a male seeking the services of prostitute at the time of the messenger, was lashed 100 times because Allah wanted to cure the new Muslim society or the new people from these diseases. Think of it like this. This is a new faith and the people who follow it are fornicators. It just doesn't go together while the Prophet is alive. Other people did something even worse. Remember the ayah was the Surat Al Ahzab was revealed 4 years, towards 4 years, three years before the death of the messenger. So the messenger has already lived between 6 to 7 years in Al-Madina. Some people, the believers of Al-Madina, new people came to Islam and things like that, they had slave girls. You know what they did, these believers? They used to force their slave girls into prostitution. I know this surprises you. Allah, I know, I understand this. There is nothing I can hide here. Guess why? Because it is in the Quran. If it were in a book of history, I will say, you know what, this book of history, maybe it's not true. Maybe they just added it. But it's in the Quran. Look what Allah orders the believers in Al-Madinah. He tells them, وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَاءِ, and do not force your girls, the slave girls, into prostitution. إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَصُّنًا, if they want to remain chaste, don't force them into prostitution. Not if she wanted to prostitute, go ahead. No, the girls did not want to prostitute. It's the sahabi, the companion, those pious companions, the predecessors, the righteous predecessors, that used to force their girls into prostitutions. And then Allah says, لِتَبْتَغُوا عَرَضَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, so that you gain some of the worldly things here on earth. Go to surah number 24, An-Nur, Ayah 33, An-Nur 24, Ayah 33, and it will tell you everything. You see, the books of history tell you that the believers were good people. They were pious, always struggling. They used to love the messenger. They were quick answering whatever Allah says. Not true. Absolutely not true. The messenger of Allah had struggled with the people of Al-Madinah a lot. Really a lot. You see, at the time of the messenger, there were a lot of destitutes and a lot of dirty people. And so the disbelievers were questioning the whole Islam message. Think, they said, if Allah was truly their God, why isn't he taking care of them? Why have they become a big problem, financially, economical, safety problem? Why? Why have these people left their homelands and came to us with all their financial and social problems? Why didn't they stay there? Why didn't they go elsewhere? Why isn't their God doing something about it? Why isn't he giving us money? Why? Why is it us who pay for their own doings? Why? And with time, after a few years had elapsed, guess what? Not much has changed. Problems were problems. Prostitution was there. And the number of believers increased and problems also with them increased. In fact, there were people who entered Islam while still not convinced of it at all. Why? Because they saw an opportunity to be taken care of. Everybody went to the messenger asking for help. And the messenger was doing his best to help. So, you know what? Being part of a big community that preaches equality, kindness, and most of all, being accepted in that community, I'll go for it. Even if I don't believe in that, I'll accept it. Allah referred to this group of people in a very particular way. He says, Ya ayyuha rasul, O you messenger, لا يحزنك الذين يسارعون في الكفر. Do not grieve over those who race fast to disbelieve. A disbeliever cannot race fast to disbeliever. Somebody else races fast to disbelievers. And then Allah tells us who were the people, the companions that used to race to disbelieve. من الذين قالوا آمنا بأفواههم. From those who say, we believed only with their mouths, they say this. ولم تؤمن قلوبهم. While their hearts do not believe. And this is in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Surah Al-Ma'idah was revealed 90 days before the death of the messenger. 90 days. Less than 3 months. And the ayah is 41. So as you can see here, Allah is telling his messenger, even 90 days before you die, there were people who said they believe, but in fact they are not believers, because it's only they say it. And they are always quick to take the choice of disbelief. These people were the hypocrites. And mind you, this ayah, as I said, was revealed 90 days before his death. But you know, the books and men of religion lied, but the Quran didn't and doesn't lie. This is why the Quran had to be kept away. It doesn't permit the existence of the lies that exist today. The books of history, the hadith, that's why I'm telling you, we have a parallel religion, a religion that is contradictory and different to that that is in the Quran. This is why when you discuss things with other people and you use only the Quran, you seem like they are on a planet, and you are on a planet. And it's the truth, because none of you is actually with each other. You use the Quran, they're not. So I will here stop, inshallah, and go to part 3 to carry on with this topic, historical topic. Assalamu alaikum.